Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Juma Game Reserve and welcome to our morning safari. My name is Mark, Jason with me on camera, and Alex is back in our control room. Welcome to a lovely morning at Juma Game Reserve. It's clearing up a little bit. There's a little bit of low cloud flying across the sky, so hopefully we're not going to have any weather, and hopefully the sun's going to burn us all away by mid-morning. We haven't really got much of a plan this morning. I did hear some guinea fowl shouting down below the dam wall, so we're going to go down onto Twin Dams Road and see what we can find down there. Other than that, we're going to wander around and have a look at whatever it is out there today. You ready, Jason?
Let's do this.
Where are the Argonauts? The Argonauts. We're going in search of the Golden Fleece today. This is Argo, the ship. Getting a bit of a break in the weather, which is good. Increasing the amount of animal activity. Let's see, we've got hyena, zebra, wildebeest. The young giraffe was here too. Let's see what else there was. Quite often I'll choose a direction based on tracks where we're gonna go. But unless I find something, I'm just gonna head down to where I heard a noise. Listen to what's going on the game drive radio. Listen to where the guys are this morning and what they're talking about. Can also give us a direction to travel in, but sounds like nothing really happening on Western Gowrie. It's all up to us this morning finding something big and grey would be good. Oops. making a noise in the drainage line here, but it's strange because they should be at the dam. Oh, they're flying. Further down towards Chilipan. Could well be that it's mainly just a couple of geese having an argument over territory. Interesting though. Hashtag Safari Live if you want to send in any tweets.
If you want to send in any
questions through Twitter. Otherwise, questions@wildearth.tv is the email address. Live after this bit of rain. Hello, little redback, female redback shrike right next to us. Is she still here?
She's going up that way. There she stands. That's up. To your left. Go forward a little bit. There you go.
A bit far out she goes. Oh, she nearly got caught up in a thorn there. Female redback shrike. Lion tracks, muddy lion tracks. Nice. I don't know if they were here from yesterday. Problem with mud and the way the ground is so soaked at the moment is that sometimes tracks like that can stay there and stay looking fresh for a couple of days. It's not like when you have tracks in soft sand, the wind tends to erode the tracks, tends to soften the edges over time. So with muddy tracks and with ground continually seeping the way it is, this big male was here, but it looks like it could have been yesterday. Not too sure what you guys had yesterday. I know you had a hippo fight on the... these tracks are old. They've been driven over from yesterday, so I'm not gonna get too excited about them. And the water's still flowing, and this is the little drainage line that comes from Philemon's Dip, from that pump house where we saw Mvula 2 days ago. Still flowing quite nicely. Was walking down Twin Dams Road, must have maybe come past the dam. So I'm wondering if anybody saw lion at the dam 2 days yesterday morning, night before last. That's the Juma waterhole camera. Would have come past there perhaps. Although we didn't see anything down that way. Hmm. and quite a bit, there seem to be up and down here. Must have been yesterday morning. And then heading off to Twin Dam. I suppose they then probably crossed over onto the other property. Just flown. Evidently a few people are asking about the hippos that were fighting yesterday. I can't give you an update, I'm afraid. I haven't even seen them. I guess I could ask if there's anybody that's been on camera, any of the zoomies, that whether they've seen anything. But I don't know, really. I haven't seen them, and I haven't been past the dam. It was a plum-coloured starling here, or violet-backed starling. It was in the road. Beautiful light on it in this morning light, but that has gone. Thank you to Diane. Diane mentioning that there were lion roaring. Thanks for the info. Maybe send Alex a message, you know, when it was that lions were roaring. I've seen them as yet, but it would be interesting to know when that was. It would be the same time frame that these lions were walking, because it would have been them walking on Twin Dams Road. They might have actually crossed over, but I'm not seeing any footage here. There are car tracks, there are some vehicle tracks on top of that lion track. Unless it's somebody driving fairly fresh tire tracks. It'll be interesting to know what sort of time frame we're looking at, when those lions were roaring. Anything in the riverbed, because there's no tracks up there anymore. I don't know if any of you remember, but a few years ago, there was a New Year's Eve party here in the riverbed, and occasionally people come and have a barbecue from the lodge. They have an outside dinner called a bush braai. I guess this fell off a table. Nice spot to have a dinner. Either that or the cats are starting to have table etiquette. They need to learn some manners at the table, the cats, especially those lion, the way they squabble over their food. Elephant was digging in the sand just at that spot where we lost signal. Often you'll find, even though the water holes are filling, found in some of the water holes, not quite particular about the visit they drink, and by digging holes in the sand hit the table, and then sand actually filters the water for them, so it's pretty in water. Anyways, a baby terrapin was swimming in there. There's still water that is seeping out of the ground. Some of the seep lines collecting in the drainage lines, accumulating. It shows how high the water table is because it's just above the layer of sand. probably one of the prettiest little dams, twin dams, when it's full. Look, I head over the dam wall maybe and see. Thick knees have got chicks. Kind of place you could sit all day and just watch life happen. Not too much in the way of activity, I suppose, because of the amount of water everywhere else. It's not likely to attract too much attention. Still a lovely place, peaceful place to sit. So, as lion, we're heading south. I'll just have a quick look on Garay. See where they crossed. We want to get back to the middle part of Juma. Change plans every now and then. I don't know if my radio is working properly. Have you heard Alex say? Alex, no news on the time frame for those caps. Morning, Stephanie. Thanks for a tweet. Ta-da. No, it doesn't help much. But Stephanie was saying that there was a lion about an hour ago on a neighboring property. Unfortunately, there are a number of neighboring properties. And although it helps a little, it doesn't give me any idea of where in all these thousands of acres that could have been. Although, who knows, maybe the same cats that did cross over somewhere. I'll maybe come back towards that area later. I just want to head up north a little bit. Morning, Sarah. Sarah from California. How are you this morning? Our morning. California would be late at night. Are there any eland or giant eland? Oh, behind the rocks. There are eland in the Kruger. I have seen many years ago, I saw eland here in the Sabi sand, but I don't think they've been around for a long time. Not really great habitat for eland. It's a little bit too dense vegetation. But not giant eland, or the Derby eland. We've only got the normal standard eland. An interesting flower for the ladies. Is that a Karula? Thank you to Marcia saying that the lions were at Nkoro. Well, it's not quite a neighboring property. Nkoro is very, very far from us. That's sort of right on the Kruger Park boundary. This is the Karula edulis, I think. Doesn't seem to have a split thorn spine, actually, not thorns. Single spine. Pretty flowers. Similar to the jasmine, just not as many petals. Getting back to the eland, you know, eland is something that you might see once in a lifetime in a place like this. It's like a number of years ago when we had those two ostrich that just happened to come through here. They do exist in the park, but they are rather specific about the habitat that they like. Imagining air hissing out of a tire. Battle air. There used to be a nest here, and often seen battle air in these trees. I think they must be still nesting here. That's a juvenile. Actually a snake eagle. Looks a bit wet and ruffled. there's a few people who mentioned that there's only one hippo at the dam, at Juma Waterhole Dam at the moment, but that makes sense because if they were fighting, it means that one of them was pushed off. They wouldn't both still be around unless they were still fighting. So whatever the dispute was, obviously settled, and the victor now stays at the dam. Territorial disputes between hippos can get quite messy. I would imagine that hippos, like the ones that we have in all the different dams, are because they move around quite a bit between dams, I'm sure that they come into contact with each other periodically, and not only that, but their pathways and their territorial markings are beacons, are messages to each other. The way that they establish and maintain territories or move through their territory, the habit of spraying their dung and then also walking through it so that their scent is actually walked along their pathway. And quite often you'll get a lot of, well, for other hippo, there'll be a lot of information to be told or to be gleaned from merely the scent of a hippo on its pathway. I would say that not very often they get into very serious fights because really they know each other, they live in the same area. Good news, of course, is that Jigger's back, and that with a bit of luck we'll have two vehicles on drive this afternoon. We need to hold thumbs on that one. After some extensive electrical surgery and a little bit of a transplant here and there of a relay and a sensor in its electronic system, Jigger will be back. And we'll have a two vehicle drive this afternoon with a bit of luck. Interesting from Valerie in Pennsylvania. Morning, Valerie. referring to, I mentioned some time ago about wearing white on safari. See how white stands out? You can see that frog nest above Worry Pan. How dark it is, partly because it's a warning color, but also because it just stands out and it distracts things. But Valerie wanting to know, what else shouldn't a first-time safari goer do? Try not to wear too much perfume and makeup. A lot of naturally perfumes and things have got scents that will attract insects. I'm trying to think what not to do. It's not really that much. You know, when you come on safari, generally you get a little bit of an introductory talk by your guide. It tells you what the do's and don'ts. Not very often you'll get a guide that will tell you not to wear a particular color or something. It's not really that much of an issue on the vehicles, but certainly if I'm doing walks with people, I won't take a walk if people are not dressed appropriately. It doesn't make sense. So neutral colors are always a good thing. The other thing is that it depends on where you're going. If you're going to a place like East Africa, you don't want to wear any dark colors either. Especially things like darker browns and also dark blue, because it attracts tsetse flies. So it's always nice when someone gets on the vehicle with a dark blue shirt or something, because the tsetse flies always go to them. And how's going on this? Are we stationed at the lock on central? Craig, what's the status there with vehicles? Okay, I'm coming down Drakensberg. Can I join him, please? Copy. Confirm central heading west. Copy, thanks. Okay, copy there. Impala. Where's she off to on her home? I'm a bit nervous. Probably split up from the herd because something's been stalking or chasing. Hal on Twitter. Morning, Hal. Strange question. Have I ever guided anybody famous? Well, I wouldn't know if they're famous or not.
own. I've had ambassadors and politicians and maybe an odd actor or two. Not really. One of the A-listers, I suppose, if you want to call them that. Well, now, we are approaching something that I've been hoping to get a glimpse of. Might be a little bit difficult for us being the third vehicle here at the back of this. What we're doing here is a surprise. Something walking on the road. And it's very difficult for the vehicles to pull off and for everyone to get a good view. So we'll see how we can maybe squeeze a glimpse somewhere. All right, copy that. Yeah, I'm behind you guys. Maybe I'll just go back and see if I can find him. Easy going back. Evidently the other cat that was with was here, that joined up with her briefly, was the quarantine male, one of her boys from her last litter. And he was back there where we saw that impala. I thought the two of them might have been still on the road. Maybe we should go back and see if we can find him. Because she's, let's see her, she's doing her usual thing, walking along the road, turning and spraying him. Maybe let's just go back, if we can have a look for quarantine, because these guys will be with her, I hope, for a little while, unless she goes into some really deep vegetation, thick vegetation. The two of them interact, see how she would have behaved towards him. It would invariably vary depending on mood. And there were times when the third litter was moving around with her that she would meet up with her second litter, and the boys would get on quite well with their new sibling. Very tender moments, in fact. There was one time when Induna was sitting on a termite mound and his baby sister, Shivinzi, came up to him and just tapped him lightly on the nose. It looks like vehicles are in here. This cat, other cat could be here somewhere. Back towards where that impala was. And obviously we're more impala, but must have split up because she's still here. She's still looking a bit nervous. guessing game where this leopard could be. I'm just going to try and find him. We'll see if we can pick up on anything. It's all shouting. Oh, the cheetah cut. Oh, that's why. That's a little flying. But those squirrels don't tend to shout at Batalier too much. Get back up into cheetah cut line, come round again back to central. And who knows, it might come out somewhere. There's the Batalier. Tammy, if we can get, we'll see if we can get the eagle. It's going to be a bit difficult. As long as it stays there. Go ahead. No, I didn't copy. I'm on Drakensberg and I'm going to just do a loop back up to Cheetah Cut Line. Okay, copy, thanks. Juvenile Batalier. Takes them about seven years, I think, to get their adult colours. So this is, oops. Difficult to age a juvenile like this. It's not quite even showing any colouring. Not quite getting its adult. Although its tail is shortening, it's weird how as a juvenile the Batalier has a fairly long tail and then as an adult they've got a much shortened tail. I suppose it's all got to do with aerodynamics and learning how to fly. Okay, let's move along. I think they might have lost Karula. Moving into some thick bush down into a drainage line. We will find out shortly. It is the nature of the beast, I guess, that we have to wait. That we have to be patient.
Working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us. Welcome back, folks. I'm not too sure why we lost you at such a perfect moment. We had her drinking a little bit of water in a puddle on the road, and unfortunately with the other radio going, a lot of activity on the radio because of the vehicles moving out, vehicles moving in, her moving around, and necessary to be on that radio. I guess that's possibly what it was. It's using that other radio as much as we try not to. It is necessary to be able to coordinate all the vehicles, otherwise the vehicles are either going to crowd her or maybe too many vehicles, so it's very important that we do manage to coordinate things very well. Oh shit, Isaac tracking today? How are you? Very good, new morning all. But I'm glad you're back, and I'll try and stay off the radio now. We'll see. She's heading steadily down towards Vuyatela, towards Juma Waterhole camera and the dam. Stopping every now and then, ears pricking up for something when she maybe hears or sees something off in the bush. The biggest issue with this, of course, with vehicles that want to watch her is being able to share the sighting. It's opening up a little bit now, maybe easier for vehicles to sort of sit abreast. And if you look way down the road, you can see this road runs straight down towards Vuyatela, and down at the bottom you can see the roof of one of the chalets at Vuyatela Lodge, the main camp here at Juma. I think what we'll do is we'll just pull off where it's convenient and watch her walk down the road, and we'll have to let some others come in front of us and let them take the lead for a little bit. Actually finding the right spot to pull off. Not really concerned with us behind her. Her ears do turn back just to keep track of where we are. The idea is to try and match her pace and not force her off the road or force her to walk any faster. I think here's a fairly good spot. We can just try and sit here and see how much we can follow her. I don't know. I don't know. They're probably still east. Sorry. Very difficult to get to. I find it very difficult to understand one person when two people are talking at the same time. I can't hear either one. My brain doesn't split the two conversations. So I think Craig, Alex was asking me something about Karula's cubs. If she were to be killed, would another female come in and take over the cubs? I'm not sure. Who was that from? Brenda. Morning, Brenda. Brenda sent an email wanting to know if something happened to Karula. Would another female step in and take over the cubs, or would the father step in? No, neither would happen. That depends, Brenda. It depends on the age of the cubs, of course. That's a very important thing. First of all, no, definitely not. If another leopard came across her cubs, they would kill her cubs. If her cubs are very, very young, they will probably die, especially if they're still being weaned. Leopard, on the other hand, are very much instinctive when it comes to hunting. I mean, from a very, very young age, as soon as their eyes are open, leopard are chasing things. And leopard can also subsist on a diet of a lot smaller prey than, say, lion or cheetah. And she's gone. I think she's kind of had enough, or she's just gone off the road for some reason. The youngsters are likely to start learning how to chase things and catch things from a very young age. So it depends solely on the age of the cubs whether they would survive or not. But generally, nothing is going to really. No other leopard will be able to come in. especially, you know, within her territory. Let's see if I can just... She was watching something. Very definite suckle marks. Very unusual circumstances to be sort of lined up behind her like this, trying to all get a glimpse. Maybe if we stop here we'll be able to see her going up the road there. Would walk on the left. And we got it. Turn the camera away from her now with the vehicles getting in the way. We do have an obligation to avoid where we can, avoid putting people on camera. And just the way that the ground lies, just the way things are at the moment, it's really difficult not to. Be a time we used to be able to drive up this little drainage line under the big jackalberry, but that doesn't seem to be possible anymore, just by this, judging by the amount of ground that's washed away over the last 2 or 3 years. Well, it does open up a little bit once we get through here up onto Gary cut line. I'm guessing she's still going to carry on straight towards Juma Dam. Back to Brenda's question, lion are really the only cats, being social of course, they're the only cats who are likely to look after another lioness's cubs if something happens. They're in the same pride, but it never happen if they're different prides. turning up towards what was the cut line by the looks of things. Not going to the dam. Ellen's asking if it's strange that we have not seen the cubs yet, or if I think that they're nearby. I don't think they're nearby. That's very hard to tell. It's not an easy one to answer that one, Ellen. The other thing is, they could be. It's not really that strange that we haven't seen them yet. They're probably still quite young. And it's entirely up to her whether she wants to expose them to vehicles. The wild hibiscus at the bottom of the screen. Turning back towards the dam. Maybe what she's doing is she doesn't want to be approaching the dam from the open of the road. She wants to maybe come in from the bush part of it. Alex tells me there are a lot of impala around on the other side of the dam probably, so it could be that she's just trying to find her way through here where she's not going to be seen. Fowl are making a noise. Now these are the guinea fowl that were making a noise when we started drive this morning. course now the whole world knows there's something going on as the guinea fowl are making a noise. All it'll do is really maybe just alert potential prey that there's something moving around. Could be that this is where her cubs are. So I think we might be very lucky, folks. This is the first we're going to see. Oh, look at it, there it is.
There it is. That is so cute.
There it is. One little baby. Okay, little. Okay, so unfortunately little one is probably experiencing vehicles for the first time now. Very, very thick vegetation where this knobthorn has been pushed over many, many years. Actually, sorry, it's a marula. It's a knobthorn. She's not happy with us. I'm sorry, girl. I'm sorry. And it's not me making a note. We also shouldn't be three vehicles here. Little one has crawled through to the back. Of just make very slow movements, eh? She gave us a little bit of a snarl. Seems to be only one cub that we can see for now. Did you get that on camera?
I did.
Good for you. Yeah, she's just calling it back now. She probably wants to suckle. Amazing that she's brought the cub here. Probably a few days ago, maybe even yesterday. It's coming back. Coming back to her. No one's coming back to her. I can see a little bit of movement at the back there. I don't know if it.
There it goes.
Has it gone back again?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, these guys mustn't move around too much with the vehicles. A little bit too much activity here. See, we would never have known that that's what she was doing. She was coming back here all along. Now. That we followed her here and that the cub is here, maybe it can be controlled a little bit differently, but up there, cub's just here now behind her. But I think one of the smallest leopards I've ever seen. just try and reverse a little bit. As soon as there's movement, the cub sort of hides, but it'll probably come out again, I hope. My heart is beating, because this is just really an incredible moment, and I've been very, very lucky in the past to have that moment of seeing her cubs for the first time. But the last time I had this experience, they were a lot older than this little one. They were already running around with her. Age-wise, I'm guessing maybe about 3 weeks, 4 weeks. Morning, Bob. Wanting to know, what are the chances of mum and baby moving away by tomorrow? I think, Bob, your guess is as good as mine. There's a chance that she'll still be here, and there's a chance that she'll have moved, especially now that she's, I don't know, this is a behavioral thing. This is something that only Karula can tell. And I don't even think if she could talk right now, she'd be able to tell us. I think it'll all hinge on what transpires in this area over the next 24 hours, whether or not she moves or takes it with her, or she leaves it here, goes off and hunts somewhere else, whether she's using this as a temporary den site. Very difficult to be able to predict what an animal is or isn't going to do. Oh, the hyena coming in. This is not good. This is not good at all. Oh, she jumped down and gave the hyena a good smack. This is very, very bad. You horrible children. Go away, children. My heart is even beating more now. In fact, I'm starting to shake. This is one of the tensest moments in any cat's life, not only a cat that is a solitary cat, but a cat that's got a cub. A hyena probably sniffing around, because there is an old carcass here, just behind us, from a fairly large animal. I think so, yeah, they've got it. Oh man. Oh man. Oh boy, this is sad. I've just got shivers. This is terrible. Probably probably one of the worst moments anybody can have when you're living in the bush and you're exposed to the wonders of nature. It is a really horrible thing to witness, but there's nothing that can be done. There's nothing. There's nothing that could have prevented this from happening. Look at her. Sorry, I'm just going to stop here for 1 minute and then I'll move.
There was only one.
I only saw the one.
Yeah, I just saw one. And that missing palika with the mukipa.
Yeah. It took it from this slit from here. There is a pretty deep hole underneath it, that fallen marula tree, which is where she probably had it, but for some reason, I don't know, for some reason, maybe with the noise of the hyena being here. Could be that the cub came out of that hole, just behind her at the root base of that fallen marula tree. Was a deep hole, and if the cub had stayed in there, oh my word, this is terrible. This is the first time in any of her litters that she's lost a cub. So she's been a very good mum up until now. I can't. Look at her, she's looking back at the hole. She's. Turn this volume down. That vehicle should not have children on it making a noise. I don't know what to say, folks. I'm speechless. It's just a moment in time that we just happen to witness something that has been going on for millions of years. A conflict of predators. She tried her best. She fought with them. She even jumped onto that one hyena's back. She jumped out of the tree and actually gave it a good nip and a good claw. But I think the more she was determined to fight, the more they knew there was something that she was fighting for. But they could also smell it. There's no doubt that there's the scent of a cub here. We did only see one. I don't know if there was another one. There was only the one cub that was visible. But those hyena came out of nowhere. There was unusual how they just appeared. They must have picked up the scent and just honed straight in on her. It was so quick. Hope that that cub would stay safe underneath that tree. But there's also the determination and the persistence of hyena. If they know something's up, they're not going to give up easily. I've seen hyena sitting under a tree with a leopard killing up at the top, and they'll wait until the very, very last for any scrap that might fall, or for a chance to have a snap at the leopard when it comes down. What's interesting is that once they got what they wanted, they've gone. They left her alone. Well, the other thing is that being a cat, she can come into estrus fairly soon. She'll come into estrus within the next few weeks even. Strong possibility that within 4 or 5 months, maybe 6 months or more, she might even have more cubs. Don't know whether she'll wait until next summer. It's obviously a lot better in the wet season, better hiding places. But it's not necessarily a summertime thing. For her, it's always been that she comes into estrus when her cubs are sort of just under 2 years old. So that's almost on the birthday, on the second year birthday of her previous litters, when she's giving birth to her next litter. So that kind of, that cycle has now been broken for the first time, this being her fifth litter. It would be interesting to find, to follow over the years to come, the next year or so, to see whether or when she gets covered again. Yeah, it's picking up to the guinea fowl calling again. For whatever reason, they're starting to make a noise again. don't know how many times I've been asked the question, especially with Karula and having followed her and her cubs for so long in previous years, what would happen if we were witnessing something like this. And it's always a speculative thing, it's always a very difficult question to answer, because the obvious answer is, well, we have to stand back here, we can't do anything. And as much as our heart and as much as even the mind is tempted to and desperately wanting to change the course of events, there isn't physically anything that can be done. There would have been, I mean, two very aggressive hyenas and one very aggressive leopard. How does one even begin to change the outcome of something like that? Dead. Of course, the question is, if we weren't following her, we would never have known. We would have been in the dark completely. We would have been looking for her cubs for weeks to come and wondering why she wasn't bringing them out. And eventually, I guess, we would have got the message that maybe they didn't survive. It's not the first time leopards have lost cubs. Certainly the first time ever on camera, which is not a great thing. Although it has been filmed for documentary purposes in other parts of Africa. I don't think we've ever had this on live, on a live broadcast, with the loss of a cub. It's almost like she's bewildered. It's almost like she's... not quite sure what to do next. Being the first time, I guess, that she's lost a cub in this way. There wasn't even time for that little one to get into a tree, even if it probably could have got into a tree. There isn't really anything here, a little bush behind her. Or if it could have gotten on top of that and pushed that fallen marula tree. Ifs and buts and what ifs. Unfortunately, they don't count anymore. Thank you.
It's going to start getting hot. I have to move soon. At least into the shade. It's almost like she just doesn't want to leave. She's as stunned as we are, if not more so. I can't imagine what this cat's thinking right now. I'm wondering if the hyena weren't just nearby and they heard her calling the cub, they heard her talking to the cub. It's so uncanny how they just came tearing in. How they, it's almost as though they knew. I don't know, it was very, very strange. Going deep into there, maybe she's got another one in there. She's lying down right there in that hole. Not going to move just yet. She probably only just recently brought it here. I think I'm gonna move and get it. Might have to. Certainly a very good spot.
but it just proved a little bit too vulnerable today. She might have been in the process of moving it to a more secure place. Or maybe she brought one here. I don't know, hard to tell. We don't know whether she had one or two, or even three. And I don't know if there's another one hiding behind her and she's still protecting it. I'm guessing it was only the one, because when she came back here, there was just the one little one running around to greet her. If there were others, I think they would have come out as well. But not an easy call to make. Heck in the way, as usual.
don't know whether we should sit here for a while or leave her be.
There are other vehicles coming. We do need to make space, I guess. This incident this morning has really changed my mood considerably. There's not really much that can be said. No. It was so quick. We're gonna leave. No, the vehicle's coming. Sorry, in the way again. There's my hex in the way. really any words. There's no, I don't know what to say now. I'm just completely blown. All the speculation that she would shoot them and when she'd bring them out and when she would move them. Turn the radio down now. We need to do that chatter anymore. So what should we do? Unlighten the mood a little bit. So now we can do that. That's something one forgets. So many times people ask, have you ever seen anything amazing? So now we can do that. That's something one forgets. So many times people ask, have you ever seen anything amazing? Never forget something like that. So, going from elation to shock. But in a matter of seconds. I don't know what it is about this sort of thing. You know, I've seen impala lambs being eaten alive, I've seen buffalo calves being eaten alive, I've seen all sorts of things, but the death of a young leopard somehow, I don't know why, maybe it's because we imbue them with such majesty and such importance, and because the impala are so numerous that when an impala lamb gets taken by a wild dog or a baboon or whatever, almost as though it's an acceptable thing. It's a common occurrence that it becomes, one becomes desensitized a little bit. And at the end of the day, oh, I don't like that phrase, but the basics of it all is that it is merely, it's life and death out here, that's what it is. We drive around, view wildlife as it happens. It's what it's all about. It's what it's, what. One can't choose what to watch and what not to watch. If you want to come and explore nature, you want to experience nature, that is what nature has to offer. Nature has its beauty and its wonderful magical moments, but that harshness that does exist, the harshness that one comes across every now and then shouldn't really affect us very much. We just voyeurs. Our paths diverged from that of the natural world so long ago that we have our modern lives and our technology. Where? Oh, look at that. Two hingeback tortoises. Looks like the male was trying to entice the female. Yeah, he's moved off now. Thank you.
go back a little bit. See if they're going to meet up again. I don't think so. It's lost in the grasses. Harrier hawk just left its nest. Thought we might be able to catch a glimpse of it. What is the difference between a tortoise, a turtle, and a terrapin? That's a question from Kathy in Tennessee. By Kathy. Well, I guess primarily the tortoise is the one that lives on land, and the turtle is the one that lives in the sea, and the terrapin is a freshwater turtle. And in different countries, common names people call things by different names. And though there are tortoises that are called turtles, there are terrapins that are called turtles, but realistically tortoises are land dwellers and turtles are marine dwellers.
And we have pool and wallows and terrapins. There are physiological differences between the three as well. Marine turtles will only ever come on when their legs, otherwise they... And so they have flippers for feet, as opposed to our fresh terrapins that have flattened feet. They're not exactly the same as a tortoise's foot. Terrapins have very, very helped. Of course, the tortoises have short, sub round feet. And all that tortoises to that, no? When they're active, they are quite able to move about on land quite a lot. Oh, Africa eagle, was it? No, that could have been a... Oh, what is that eagle? Wahlbergs. Chasing, there's a goshawk or a sparrowhawk there as well. Yeah, railway birds screaming their lungs out. That's that Wahlbergs we saw a little while ago. Pale phase, mostly pale underneath, darker on top. I'm sure they're trying to catch something here. Most likely going after Franklin or something. Where those lion went. Were here this morning, but it was following their tracks. I wonder where they ended up.
tracks on the other road, on the main road. They crossed sand. I'm gonna show that to you. Maybe. Mark. So, cats were on Western Gowrie this morning, last night, and they have now crossed over to the other side of the road. Let me try and find something else to follow, of course. No, it just happened so quick. It was behind bushes. It was very tight in there.
So that's the way it works, eh?
It was quick, eh? I mean, 1 minute she arrived there, and the next minute they came out of nowhere. They just came flying in as though they knew.
They were just waiting for her.
I don't know. Yeah. They must have picked up scent somewhere. Maybe they'd be there hanging around because of that old carcass. Who knows? But they. I think also maybe they heard her calling the cub.
Okay.
And that sound, they would have known what sound is. So they would have come. They came flying in. And it was
quick.
If the little one had stayed underneath that root ball of that marula, maybe. But it must have been cautious out or something. Anyways.
I'll spot you later.
That is what we have to live with. From Cheetah Plain, I guess in a way I was lucky he missed it. He'd been following Karula most of the morning and then gave up his spot for us, I guess, and takes him. Maybe later we'll go over to see what's on Arethusa. Western Guard. Hopefully Craig will be back with Jigger
in the morning.
Scott.
Craig, did I say Craig?
Yeah.
Oh, Scott. Sorry, Scott. I meant Scott. Did I say Craig? I don't know. But yeah, hopefully things will change later. Brain's mushed now after this morning. I need a 360 degree turnaround. There's something nice. Two Nyala bulls sparring. If we can get to see them in this thicket. Not likely, maybe. I'm thinking this might be a little bit soft. Maybe from this angle. I think I'm going to go really going at it too hard. There's normally a lot of posturing with Nyala bulls. There are quite a few of them here by the looks of things. Three, four, at least four of them. With some impala. So this is just a bachelor herd of Nyala. A couple of them, just a couple of these big boys. Just hello boys, you can carry on if you want. When they are challenging each other for dominance and for access to females, there's more of a strut and more of a show that goes on. They have an incredible dorsal crest that they raise. And almost like they raise their hackles. He's just been shown the door. Not easy to see with the worry bush in the way, but there's just about to raise the crest. But they do a lot of strutting. There's a posturing and slow motion strutting that they circle each other with, and as a precursor to fighting. Sometimes they don't really get as far as clashing horns. I'm just looking at a lot of the tracks. Looks like they've been at it for a while. This ground is getting very soft. We need to be out of this right from here. A bit too sensitive after the rain. The ground, I mean, I'm a little bit too sensitive after this morning. Bye bye, boys. That'll change things. A new lucky call. Me if I put it somewhere sticking up, I'll forget that it's there. It was a painful experience. A lot of bacteria on the quills of a porcupine make it kind of a little bruising that happens when you get jabbed by one. I've never been jabbed by a porcupine quill that's still attached to a porcupine. It's always been a quill that I've picked up and I've put somewhere and I inadvertently sit on it or put my arm on it or yes.
jab myself. Must be extremely painful for leopard and lion and some of the dogs, jackal, and they try and catching a porcupine and they get those quills in their mouth and their neck, their paws. Pardon?
Is this the yellow camelina that you're talking about?
Must be.
We're gonna put it on camera now.
There's another nice plant there. Camelina africana. Here's one closer to the camera, I think. Maybe this side of the vehicle. Find a nice one with its face towards the camera. The yellow camelina. I'll show you the blue one and the yellow one.
That's a blue one.
I suppose I could pick one since they're a common flower and I'm not damaging the plant, merely taking the flower there. There's a variety of camelinas. Camelinas and anilinas. Spider's got a fly. Right here. That's actually one of those biting flies.
Where is it?
Right here where my finger is. Well, we can just about make out the... if I hold it. Sorry, I know I'm moving it, I'm just trying to manipulate it, but of course it's... There we go. The salticid or jumping spider that's caught. It's related to the horse flies, it's very closely resembling a tsetse fly in fact, and they also do bite, known as a clegg. One of the most amazing groups of spiders, these salticids, the jumping spiders, because they have the ability to turn their heads in ways that other spiders don't. They've also got vision that is being a hunting spider that jumps onto its prey, pounces on its prey, little hydraulic, almost in fact pneumatic legs. Incredible ability to jump, the jumpers. I hope you can make it out. Okay, and off she goes. You get jumping spiders that mimic ants, and almost for almost every species of ant you will find that the jumping spider that looks exactly like the ant, and it actually hunts the ant species that it looks like, and to get away with pretending to be an ant, lifts its front pair of legs to pretend they feel as like an ant, and they'll waft them around. And I think they're even able to produce a similar pheromone to the ant, so that the ants don't pick up their scent, and they're able to snatch an ant out of a column. But very often I've seen ants ganging up on the spider and actually preventing the spider from claiming its prey. So the spider's got to bite the ant and then follow the ant until the venom takes effect. Also, venom only really being effective on prey, not on humans. None of the jumping spiders are dangerous or of any significance. I don't think I've been to Treehouse since the rain's filled it up.
buffalo today.
But I guess the buffalo now have mud wallows and puddles everywhere. They don't necessarily have to stick to the confines of the dam.
This, right?
No, it's not.
lizard. The Nile monitor. We've been watching some of the white-throated monitors previously. Not quite an adult, it still can grow. This one is probably already about, I'd say maybe nearly 3 feet head to tail. 2.5 to 3 feet. It'll probably grow up a lot more in time. Well, we've come to the end of the drive for this morning, folks. It hasn't been very active as far as questions and answers go. I've been a little bit subdued after that experience. Thanks for joining us, though. Thanks for being part of it. And we will see you this afternoon, 4 o'clock Central African time. From myself, Mark, and Jason on the vehicle, Alex back in final control, and the rest of the crew, thanks for joining us, and we'll see you a little bit later. And you, Mr. Monitor Lizard, we'll see you too. Goodbye. Loves you lots.